discussion in the last class, in the last session, and also I'm getting a huge number today, almost like 23 people present for this session. Could you please quickly, in 1 or 2 minutes, briefly, tell whatever you have to say, because I missed out on whatever you wanted to say. Particularly Dr. Shakir Hussain was saying something, then I couldn't, perhaps you couldn't hear me, I could hear you. But if you have something to say, that these are the kind of areas or whatever you feel like, trying to
No, sir.
say to the.
I have just give the brief about the technology, science, and the empire. So and the summary of the topics and the how the topics is related to the Britishers and the modern Indian history. That was discussing just,
So
sir.
you have given
You
an
can
introduction.
yes, sir.
You
A
have given
small brief.
an.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Professor
Now.
Misra, Professor Misra, would you like to say something? Professor Misra, is he there? Hello?
Yes, sir,
Hello?
he's here. I think he's.
Ask him to put on this earphone so that he can hear me. And also to the students, particularly if they have any questions from the beginning itself, to come up with. I don't mind if they can come up with few questions so that we can at least start brainstorming on these questions. We can straight away take on these questions and get into the lecture. Is there any questions from the students? And particularly, they could be very fascinating discussions also. Is there anyone who would like to say a few words? Amit, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. I can hear you, sir.
And Professor Misra, ask Professor Misra to be there. Is he there?
Yes, sir. He's there, sir.
But he can't hear me.
Yes, sir. I'll just call him, sir. Just a moment, sir.
Maybe he's away from the phone.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's like this.
Just ask him.
Patita Bhavan, sir, can you please unmute your mic and. Hello, sir.
अरे फोन हेलो इज नॉट देयर हेलो एनी हाउ सो आई डोंट नो टुडे शुड आई स्टार्ट राइट नाउ.
Yes, sir, we can start now, sir.
Get away with your me. Anyhow, good. It's always a bit of a challenge for students of history, for particularly critical students of history and historians like you who are studying and doing masters in history, to come up with a theme like how to make sense of this idea of what they have called RAS, science, technology, or in other words, the way the British order or the colonial order, as you all must be aware of this fact that we usually refer to British rule as colonialism, because it had a structure which is more appropriately is described as colonial structure, and this is part of colonialism. And as long as we tend to see this foreign rule or this British rule as the structure, we refer to it as colonialism. So within that framework of order, which we call colonial order, how science and technology developed in India. And if you remember that colonialism, British was with us, was with India in the 18th and sorry, in the 19th century mostly, and also prior to that, they came as traders and many European powers came as traders, and also the East India Company had a very vibrant presence in India starting from late 18th century till about 19th century, and then on then also the British rule. So during this time, how India coped with this idea of science, how India reconciled to the new ideas of science, science as a form of knowledge, you know. Then when we pose this question, when we try to think through this question, one of these major you know, corollary of this debate would be to understand whether, why should we talk of science only when British come to us, when British came to India? And does it mean that India lagged a tradition of science beforehand? That is a fundamental question which should bother you. Many of you would also be very tempted to ask, does it mean that science and technology was something foreign to India, and we only need to talk about the presence of science and technology only in the context of colonialism? That's a very, you know, very familiar and also a very obvious question to be posed. That is one thing that we need to ask. Then once we settle this question, of course, supposing we agree to it that no, India had, you know, at least a respectable degree of cultivation in this domain of science and technology, and they had medicine, they had astronomy, they had understanding of surgery and many other things in the ancient times, and also in the medieval times, if you look back, a text of 11th century talks about the fact that India was one of those first countries, you know, one of these major countries who cultivated science as who cultivated science first, you know, at the early stage. India was one of them. So if there are references, literary references, or textual references to the idea of cultivation of science way back in the 11th century, we cannot simply accept of a tradition of science and technology before the British came. That cannot be simply accepted. But then we need to do a lot of research to find out what was the nature of science and technology, what was the nature of science, or how did the ancient Indians or the Indians of medieval times had this understanding of scientific tradition. That these are the, you know, nuanced questions which need to be answered. Having said this, since this discussion is veering around this question of the nature of science and technology, the way it developed, the way it shaped up during the colonial period, and then also in the post-colonial India, in the post-independent India, and this tradition of science and technology, the way you see it today, in the last, the way it has shaped up in the 70 years, does it mean that this tradition only developed during the British period, and on the foundation of this, that we could very comfortably build up a very robust scientific tradition after independence? So these are some of the fundamental questions that you need to keep it in mind. Having said this, I would just quickly go on to share with you some of the ideas about what was the nature of, you know, the way people looked at this whole tradition in the context of colonialism, in the context of British rule. The moment the time when British came to India or the Western powers came to India, and when they came to India, they came with their own understanding, knowledge of science and technology, whether it is a sheep, whether it is a gun, whether it is a some kind of technological marvel, whether it is coal, whether it is steamship, whether it is some kind of that is something. The sense mean that had missed out that was, ground. If you look back to time, you look back you from 15th century onward till about Europe is rising, industrial revolution, technology, whether it is education, every word and we refer to this in 18th century. And traditional idea they don't see or good one it about basically as we speak Europe this state exploring different continent another when what naturally or the book is scientific yes in and should the doc what is or it's in the So when East India Company came to India, they came not only but when they did a doubling opportunity for that profit which will they will own and that how to do that profit in this country. How to maximize that country. So they thought that they will use their own knowledge. That knowledge was science which they had in the last the idea was their time. Well,
hello. Short. Sir? Excuse me, sir. Yes, sir. Sorry to interrupt, but sir, your voice is breaking, sir. We are not able to hear you, sir, clearly.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Now I can.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
For how long you have not been hearing me?
So for 5 minutes, sir.
Sorry, immediately you should have told me. Sorry about this. Anyhow, okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Now I can hear you, sir.
Everyone. Okay. So what I was trying to tell you that when East India Company came or when the European powers came to India, whether as missionary or traders, they definitely tried to use their new ideas of science, new ideas of technology, and they tried to explore this country or they tried to consolidate their governance in this country. The British rule, the colonial rule established their governance, their administration in this country. by using these new knowledge system. There are many things that we need to discuss while discussing the kind of the transmission of new ideas in the shape of science or technology to a new country like India. Does it mean that it was a total imposition? India didn't have any intellectual tradition and a new knowledge tradition was imposed on it, and there was no resistance from the country itself? That is one question that needs to be answered. Whether British came and imposed that tradition, we accepted it as mere passive receptors, as we just received it, or we opposed to it, or we tried to assimilate some of the things. This is one strand of the problematic that we need to answer. And the other possible strands could be to see whether the science which was developed in Europe, the idea of science, the tradition of science and technology, the way it developed in Europe, and when it came to India, when it was transmitted into a new, you know, geographical milieu, in a new cultural setting, like India or Africa or Latin America for that matter, did it develop a different orientation? In other words, what I mean to say, whether this science was slightly modified, the nature of that science which was there in Europe came to be, you know, adapted to a new situation, new local, new geographical mooring, cultural mooring, and that science assumed a different tonality, different, you know, characteristic feature. That is another issue that needs to be very seriously probed. And whether the knowledge, the traditions, which was also explored in the course of imposition or transmission of that scientific tradition into India, when the botanists, the geographers, the geologists, the chemists, the physicians, anybody for that matter, or the zoologists, the medical people, when they came to India and they were trying to, you know, survey this land or look at the disease profile of this country, or trying to, you know, look at the terrain of this country, the history of cyclone, the kind of rainfall this particular country has been experiencing over the centuries, or the kind of flora and fauna which exist when this botanist of Europe was looking at it, or a geologist looking at the reserve of coal. All these things, when they looked at it, they found new, you know, archives of information, new data, new database. When they use this data, when they use these ideas, and they saw something very different, they tried to, again, analyze this data on the basis of the existing theories of science, which was basically produced at a European locale, and tried to see the difference, whether some of the ideas which came from India, some of the data which are produced, which are found from India, whether they subscribe to the existing theories or contradicted these theories. That became another question. In other words, whether science from the colony or the, you know, findings from the colony, data from colony, in some way impacted the overall character of science, the theoretical science, which was already there in Europe. That is another question that you need to very seriously look at. যদি ইন্ডিয়ারু আমি কিছু জিনিস দেখুছে কিছু জিনিস পাওছে, আমি জিওগ্রাফি হিসাবে হোক, বটনিস্ট হিসাবে হোক, লাইফ সাইন্টিস্ট হিসাবে হোক, আমি যাহা যাহা সব জিনিস দেখুছে, ওটা 19th সেঞ্চুরিতে আমি যে যে জিনিস সব দেখুছে, সে জিনিসকে যেতবে আমি অ্যানালিসিস করছে, কি একটা নয়া ফাইন্ডিং দৌছি কি, যে ফাইন্ডিংটা ইউরোপের যে সায়েন্সের থিওরি আছে তাকে প্রেডিক্ট করছি, সাবস্ক্রাইব করছি, এক ইউরোপে ସେତେବେଳେ ବ୍ରିଟିଶ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆକୁ ଶାସନ କରିବାକୁ ସେତେବେଳେ ତା ଯେଉଁ ନୂଆ ନଲେଜ୍ ଏକ୍ସପ୍ଲୋର୍ କରୁଛି, କଣ୍ଟ୍ରୋଲ୍ କରିବାକୁ ଚେଷ୍ଟା କରୁଛି କଣ୍ଟ୍ରିକୁ, ଏବଂ ନୂଆ ନୂଆ ଜିନିଷ ପାଉଛି, ତାକୁ ନେଇକି ତାଙ୍କ ଥିଓରି, ତାଙ୍କର ଅଣ୍ଡରଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡିଂ, ତାଙ୍କ ନଲେଜ୍ ବି ଚେଞ୍ଜ ହେଉଛି। ତେଣୁ ମେଟ୍ରୋପଲିଟାନ୍ ଜାଗାରେ ଯଦି ଏଇଟା ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ହେଲା କଲୋନି, ମେଟ୍ରୋପଲିସ୍ ହେଉଛି ବ୍ରିଟେନ୍। ତେଣୁ କଲୋନିର ନଲେଜ୍ ମେଟ୍ରୋପଲିସ୍ର ନଲେଜ୍କୁ ଚେଞ୍ଜ କରୁଛି ନା ନାହିଁ, ସେଇଟା ଗୋଟେ କଥା। ଏକରେ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଗୋଟେ ୟୁନିଭର୍ସାଲ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ, ଆମେ ନ୍ୟାଚୁରାଲ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ ତାକୁ ୟୁନିଭର୍ସାଲ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଯେଉଁ କହୁଛେ, ସେ ୟୁନିଭର୍ସାଲ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସଟା କେବେ ୟୁରୋପରେ ତିଆରି ହେଇପାରିବନି। ୟୁରୋପ ଗୋଟେ ରିଜିଅନ୍, ସେଠୁ ଗୋଟେ ପ୍ରକାର ଜିନିଷ ଆଇଡିଆ ତିଆରି ହେଉଛି, କିନ୍ତୁ ସେ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଯେତେବେଳେ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆକୁ ଆସୁଛି ବା ଆଫ୍ରିକାକୁ ଯାଉଛି, ଲାଟିନ୍ ଆମେରିକାକୁ ଯାଉଛି, ସେତେବେଳେ ତାର କ୍ୟାରେକ୍ଟର ବି ଚେଞ୍ଜ ହେଇପାରେ। ଏଠିକାର ଡେଟା ବେସିସ୍ରେ ବା ଡେଟା ଯେଉଁ ପ୍ରକାର ଅଛି, ବ୍ୟାଙ୍କ ଯାହା ରହୁଛି ବା ଆମେ ଯାହା ପାଉଛେ ଏଠୁ, ଯେଉଁ ଇନଫର୍ମେସନ୍, ଯେଉଁ ଆଇଡିଆଜ୍ ପାଉଛେ, ସେଇଟା ବି ଇମ୍ପାକ୍ଟ ପକାଉଛି, ସେଇଟା ବି ଚେଞ୍ଜ କରୁଛି। ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ୟୁ ହାଭ୍ ଟୁ ଭେରି କ୍ଲିଅରଲି ଅଣ୍ଡରଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡ। ଇନ୍ ଅଦର ୱାର୍ଡ଼ସ୍, ୱାଟ୍ ଆଇ ଏମ୍ ଟ୍ରାଇଂ ଟୁ ପୋଜ୍ ବିଫୋର୍ ୟୁ ଫର୍ କ୍ରିଟିକାଲ୍ ସ୍କୁଲ୍ସ ଅଫ୍ ହିଷ୍ଟ୍ରି ଅଫ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜି ଆଣ୍ଡ ମେଡିସିନ୍, ଇଟ୍ ଇଜ୍ କଲ୍ଡ ଏସ୍ଟିଏମ୍, ସାଇନ୍ସ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜି ଆଣ୍ଡ ମେଡିସିନ୍, ଆଣ୍ଡ ୟୁ କ୍ୟାନ୍ ଅଲ୍ସୋ ପୁଟ୍ ଇନ୍ ଆନଦର କ୍ୟାଟେଗରି କଲ୍ଡ କମ୍ପ୍ୟୁଟର, ସାଇନ୍ସ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜି ମେଡିସିନ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ କମ୍ପ୍ୟୁଟର, ମେ ବି ବିକଜ୍ ନାଓ ଏ ନ୍ୟୁ ଏରିଆ କୁ ଡେଭଲପ୍, ବିକଜ୍ ୱି ଆର୍ ଲିଭିଂ ଇନ୍ ଏ ଭର୍ଚୁଆଲ୍ ଏଜ୍, ୱି ଲିଭିଂ ଅଲମୋଷ୍ଟ ଲିଭିଂ ଅନଲାଇନ୍, ଦି ହିଷ୍ଟ୍ରି ଅଫ୍ ଅନଲାଇନ୍ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜି ନିଡ୍ସ ଟୁ ବି ଏ ଭେରି ମେଜର ଏରିଆ ହ୍ୱିଚ୍ ହିଷ୍ଟୋରିଆନ୍ ଶୁଡ୍ ବି ଭେରି କ୍ଲିଅରଲି କନ୍ସିୟସ୍ ଅଫ୍। ସୋ ଦିସ୍ ଇଜ୍ ଏ ନ୍ୟୁ ଡୋମେନ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଅଣ୍ଡରଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡିଂ ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ହିଷ୍ଟ୍ରି ଅଲୱେଜ୍ ଅଫର୍ସ ୟୁ, ହ୍ୱିଚ୍ ଅଲୱେଜ୍ ୟୁ ନୋ ଏଣ୍ଟାଇସେସ୍ ୟୁ, ୟୁ ନୋ ଅଲୱେଜ୍ ପ୍ରମ୍ପ୍ଟସ୍ ୟୁ ଟୁ ଲୁକ୍ ଆଟ୍, ଆଇ ମିନ୍ ୱେନ୍ ୟୁ ଲୁକ୍ ଆଟ୍ ଦିସ୍ ପର୍ଟିକୁଲାର ନୋ ଆସ୍ପେକ୍ଟ ଅଫ୍ ହିଷ୍ଟୋରିକାଲ୍ ନଲେଜ୍, ୱାଟ୍ ୟୁ ଆର୍ ବେସିକାଲି ଟ୍ରାଇଙ୍ଗ୍ ଟୁ ଲୁକ୍ ଆଟ୍, ୟୁ ଆର୍ ଟ୍ରାଇଙ୍ଗ୍ ଟୁ ଡିଲ୍ ୱିଥ୍ ଦି କ୍ୱେଶ୍ଚିନ୍ ଅଫ୍ ମଡର୍ଣ୍ଣିଟି, ଯେଉଁ ଆଧୁନିକତା, ଯେଉଁ ଆଧୁନିକତାଟା ୟୁରୋପରୁ ଆସୁଛି। ଆଧୁନିକତା ଭିତରେ ଯେଉଁ ଦୁଇ ଚାରିଟା ଜିନିଷ ରହିଛି, ଟୁ ଅର୍ ଥ୍ରୀ ମେଜର ଏଲିମେଣ୍ଟ ହ୍ୱିଚ୍ ଆର୍ ପାର୍ଟ ଅଫ୍ ଦିସ୍ କନ୍ସେପ୍ଟ କଲ୍ଡ ମଡର୍ଣ୍ଣିଟି, ଇଜ୍ ୱାନ୍ ୱାନ୍ ଇଜ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜି ଅଫକୋର୍ସ, ଦେନ୍ ହ୍ୟୁମାନିଟି, ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଅଫ୍ ମ୍ୟାନ୍, ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ମ୍ୟାନ୍ ବିକମିଂ ଇମ୍ପୋର୍ଟାଣ୍ଟ। So these are other questions that are that need separate session. But now coming to this, to deal with this question of how, what was the nature of science and technology during the colonial period, and what specific impact they exerted on this society? How do we understand our country? For example, as I was trying to tell you that. Of course, we take pride in this fact that we are great, you know, medical people in the ancient period. We have Charak, we have Sushrut, definitely. And we had some understanding of surgery. We had, there was reference to the fact that India was one of those first countries to take interest in science, as far as that the reference comes from a text of 11th century, Arabic text. Okay, but what happened after that? But suddenly, what we see in the 17th and 18th century, the distance between Europe and India gets widened. You know, of course, the distance between Europe emerges as one of the most powerful nations because of a distinct cultivation of a particular form of knowledge whose basis was based on science, natural science. They had greater mastery over understanding of the nature, which most other parts of the globe didn't have that mastery. So they, because of that mastery, they could sail to different continents. They could take on voyages, Vasco da Gama, and you see so many people, you know, trying to come on the voyages and try to, you know, conquer new continents, new countries. Europe became a very serious power for the whole of the globe. And as you know, British emerged as one of those major powers when, you know, sun never Set. That's the kind of idea. So behind all this thing, the fundamental power which propelled their movement, their mobility was science. But the question is, I mean, let me take you back to one of those very initial reactions of India. How do we see how India reacted to the presence of the British in the 18th century? When British or these people came with their ship or with their hats, one of those ministers, one of those people, a part of this, cultural elite, one who called one of those ministers of Kolhapur in Maharashtra, was very scared, when they saw people coming in the sea with their hats, the Europeans. He said that the topikars mean people wearing these hats, and they had power over, they knew how to use, fire guns, and they had clear understanding over different aspects of technology. So the initial reaction of this fellow, this Amartya, or the minister, this Indian, that get away, I mean, keep away from these people, don't get into them. So this will lead to a lot of problem, a lot of crisis. So that exemplifies in many ways a kind of reaction in 17th and 18th century in the cultural context of India, that India was keeping away from these ideas of development, progress in the domain of science and knowledge. If there is a kind of technology, there is a gun, there is a steam ship, or there is some use of coal which can virtually add to the mobility or the power, then why should we try to all these things? And why should we keep away from these things? So if this fellow was very scared of these topikars, or these people with hats, because they had some greater control, greater mastery over technology, that may be or may not be a very general characteristic feature of India, as saying that India was insular, India was keeping away from science and technology, India didn't have any interest. Maybe Indian people were more interested with introspection, more interested with contemplation, more interested with philosophical reflection, but they are not interested with practice or praxis. They didn't want to get into technology, into metallurgy, into geography or geology, something like that, which the Europeans had clearly, started experimenting in great ways. That is a kind of small example to show that there was a kind of initial hesitation on the part of someone from India to keep away, to saying his people that not to get into them, so that this will complicate your problem. But having said this, we cannot take it as a general, very broader picture of India emerging in the 18th century, saying that India kept away from science and technology. On the other hand, what we could see very clearly that India, very fascinatingly and very enthusiastically, also tried to think about both the tradition of the West based on science, and also tradition of the East, as the way, whether it is the Vedanta traditions which talked of philosophy and other things. They wanted a synthesis of this. And there are also a group of people, or group of educated Indians, who basically full-fledgedly supported the idea of science and technology, supported the cause of the British. They opposed 1857, I mean, one of these mathematicians and other educated people. They said they tried to brand 1857 revolt as a kind of struggle of ignorance versus progress. They thought that resisting Britain in 1857 implies that as because we are ignorant people, because we are prejudiced, because we are superstitious people, we are trying to fight a power which is more rational, more organized, more progressive. That was a take of an Indian who is a mathematician. So there are multiple kind of reactions. There is no one way of saying this. We know how Ram Mohan Roy was very, clearly, trying to push on this agenda of reform, of development, of reason, and everything. So at one level, what you can deduce, the fight between the emphasis on reason, direct perception, sense perception, knowledge gathering, as has been, very clearly established through the philosophy of René Descartes or Newton or for the Comte or whoever in 19th century, sense empiricist, people who believed in empiricism, believed in rationalism, all these traditions of rationalism, empiricism, which had emerged as a very substantial, aspect of knowledge by 19th century or by 18th, 19th century, did it have a clear impact on India, or India latched on to or continued to also privilege its tradition of introspection, reflection, and a lot of interpretations on a conceptual, at different conceptual plane, or on a alternative conceptual, through a alternative conceptual orientation. This is one of those questions that we need to explore while talking about the nature of science and technology in the context of colonial rule or colonialism. So as can be clearly seen, 18th century, what we see that this distance between India and the West becomes widened. But at the same time, we also started looking at this interesting universe of knowledge in different multiple ways. How do we do that? Let's try to see this. Now, the first question that should be answered is that when British started expanding into Indian continent or started consolidating its rule in India, starting with the East India Company, and then as full-fledged paramount power after 1857, in both these phases, the idea was to use science, military, administration, commerce, education, everything together. So science, technology was used as a kind of very major resource to establish this Raj, to establish this colonial rule, to strengthen this colonial rule. That was what is important, that you must keep it in mind. Science and technology was just not pursued for, as a kind of intellectual fascination. It's a natural fascination. Of course, initially, people who pursued this intellectual pursuits had some kind of freedom, definitely. See, for example, when British came to India in different phases through the waves of ships to India, in their ships they had naturalist surgeons, natural, they called them the doctors who accompanied these people in the long voyage from England to India to take care of their health while traveling such long distance on the sea. There had to be doctors. The doctors came with them with these British people who were supposed to get down to India as traders and start looking at Bengal and Carnatic areas as merchants and try to find out people what kind of products they are selling, everything. So they need to be accompanied by some kind of health experts or the doctors, because this is important, because they are going to a new area. Supposing they fall sick, or supposing they become ill, who is going to take care of them? They'll die. So the idea was to have more of these people with them. But when these doctors came here, they're not all the time taking care of this health of these people. So what they did in their leisurely time or on the other time, they were looking at different cultural aspects of this country. For example, disease, for example, the kind of tendencies of the people, epidemiological aspects of this country, and also the physical climate of this country, the rainfall, the terrains, all these things. So they're also looking at flora, fauna, and slowly they will be joined by, not only the doctors, slowly the botanist came, or botany was taught in a major way in Indian universities. Because why this is botany is important, why geology was important, why geography was important? Because these people, these British who had come to India, had to go to new areas, new regions. Unless they had some understanding about the geology of this country, about the geography of this country, how could they know? So these two subjects became very important. Geography, geology became very important. And compared to other disciplines, they didn't immediately prefer to have more of physics and chemistry. These are theoretical sciences. But geography and geology are more practical, based on more of practice. And this will help, because this will enable or enhance the understanding of the British to know what are the new areas they are going to rule, what kind of climate they have, how to measure rainfall, all these questions. So these disciplines were more seriously privileged. Similarly, botany, because flora and fauna are to be understood. Unless until you understand a particular area, particular habitat, the cultural practices, anthropologists were to be more seriously cultivated in Indian anthropology, because they have to understand people of a different ethnicity, the Adivasis or the tribal people. They should know their cultural traditions and everything. So in terms of discursive practices, in terms of disciplinary practices, what you see that there are certain knowledge traditions which are more privileged, which are more emphasized than the others. So we have geography, geology, botany coming up at the top of the list, and physics, chemistry down, or for that matter, geology and medicine. Medicine, cultivation of medicine and medical subjects came much later, around 1822, and a dictionary of disease was prepared only in the 1830s, something like that, 1832. Charles Moorhead prepared this because they wanted to know what kind of disease is relevant in India. So this is, again, while pursuing science, while pursuing technology, while pursuing new knowledge traditions, it was all linked to the establishment of a colonial rule or consolidation of the state, the colonial state. So the state or the British rule has to be established, and science and technology has to come to its aid, come to its help. So here, double purpose, that the scientist had to serve the state, scientists had to serve science, scientists had to serve knowledge. When I say scientists have to serve science, I mean that way that scientists have to serve knowledge as such. So, but sometimes we say we are given to understand when we pursue knowledge, we do it. For example, you are studying history, you are pursuing it for knowledge sake, you say. But if you look at it critically, somewhere you can see that there is a that this pursuit of your particular discipline, a particular interest, a particular intellectual interest is somewhere linked to the questions of power, questions of, you know, trying to be part of a political structure or a power structure. That is another issue which we might discuss when we discuss knowledge power equation in a Foucauldian notion. I mean, that's another Michel Foucault talks about how knowledge is ultimately linked to power, you know, to power, to control, desire to know, desire to control is basically our questions, our issues which are linked to pursuit of knowledge. It's not like we always very fascinatingly or very uncritically believe that knowledge, we just believe in knowledge. We study because we want to gather knowledge. But again, knowledge is something like, you know, trying to have control over power. It's linked to power, something. So that is another question. But what I mean to, I mean, I brought, I mean, I just wanted to draw your attention to this particular aspect to suggest that there are certain disciplines, there are certain disciplinary practices like geography and geology or botany, which are becoming more important for the East India Company, for the traders, because they want to explore this country, because they want to know these people, because they want to know this climate. They want to have a very sound footing on this particular zone, particular area. And because this is, once they have sound footing, once they have sound consolidation of their administration, this will, they can have their, you know, company on a more stable framework. And once this company is established in a proper way, it can transact business with the people, and this will lead to more profit. And this is how the company will have more profit, and ultimately England will be enriched, or the property, the prosperity of this country, England, part of it is East India Company, for which it has come to India for trading. It will add to the, you know, overall natural resources, or of course the national wealth of this country can be enhanced. So science and technology, the way when it came to India, or the way when it came to be established in India, the way it was done by the East India Company was ultimately linked to these questions. For example, when somebody thought of trying to do a dictionary of economic wealth of this country, because they need to identify which things are important in India. What kind of resources are there? How to map these resources? These resources, when this, you know, whether it is products of the forest, products of the natural resources, how do we map these resources? This is one important thing that anyone who is coming for the first time to your home, they will try to see what kind of things you have, whether you are rich or poor. Similarly, a foreign country which is trying to come to India will definitely try to look forward to what kind of resources they have. But again, the emphasis was on not only economic resources, but commercial resources, because the resources should not only be mapped on the basis of economic importance, but more of commercial importance, because this should be, you know, this should be part of commercial network, part of commercial, you know, transaction, because it's a, you know, East India Company is basically about the commerce, about profit. So their emphasis was that the economist, the naturalist, the botanist, the geographers, the geologist, all of them should try to do something, do some research, or whatever they do, they should be doing science on the basis of the, on the, you know, broader, you know, objective of how to maximize profit. That was something which remained very fundamental to the initial agenda of British colonialism, the initial who use science and technology to maximize profit. That is, look. The other aspect what you need to also take note of is, they said in the beginning, all these things you try to imagine, one, science, technology, administration, education, military expansion, commerce, all these things are rolled in one. The whole purpose is to how to develop British rule, how to develop this company or this British rule based on science and technology, where commerce is involved, where the administration is involved, where the education is involved, what kind of education will be given to people. That was important because, you know, initially you can see that Asiatic Society was founded in 1784. William Jones was its major proponent. Then there are several, you know, research forums which was floated. And these are private organizations, whether it is in Bombay, whether it is in Calcutta, all these presidencies. These, you know, research and this, you know, knowledge forums which were, you know, floated by the British, the idea was to study nature and man. The idea was to study nature and man and nature. How, what is the performance of man in that particular, because Asiatic Society in Bengal, the idea of it was to see what kind of people India was having. I mean, what was the cultural traditions of India? And at the same time, how the, about the nature of India, how it has produced, what kind of production India has so far been endowed with. These are the two questions relating to man and nature, became a very philosophical, at a philosophical level, if you reduce everything, Asiatic Society, or the branch of it in Mumbai, in Bombay, all of them try to see the cultural profile of this country, also the performance, the activities of the people in India, to understand them. So, and while doing this, they use science and technology. They basically, science technology means they wanted to use their own understanding of knowledge and floated these organizations to understand more of this particular continent based on specific examination of the ideas of man and its nature in different ways, in different multiple ways. So what we see that in the initial phase, it was both colonial expansion, development of capitalism, and science went together. The idea of, you know, what they called modernization, British called that we are modernizing. So it's not modernization of capitalism, as we say, the capitalism, because they started developing this idea, or they started to propagate this idea that it has to be machine based, industry based, industrialization has to be promoted. So the regime of industrialization linked to this idea of capitalism, and which produces modernization, urbanization, secularization, whatever you call it, I mean, all these ideological spirit which man has to, you know, increasingly and progressively cultivate. Because the biggest foundational principle on which modernity came to be rested, or enlightenment tradition in Europe came to be rested, was rationalism and humanism. Belief in reason. Everything has to be sense perceived. Everything has to be sense, everything is to be based on sense perception. Nothing, I mean, we should not try to believe something on imagination or believe in the other world. We have to see everything. That was the, you know, very fundamental inaugural philosophical intervention which came from René Descartes in Europe, or many other Baconian scientists believed in, you know, at least having some, I mean, forming understanding based on sense observation, empiricism. Everything has to be proved, you know, laboratory proved or sense perceived, then we can then it can constitute as proper knowledge or positive knowledge. This idea of positivism, all these ideas were partly, I mean, were in a very major way came to be imported to India by the colonialists. But when it came, when it was sought to be imposed in India, the reaction was, you know, multiple, as I have said. At one level, we see that, as I said, capitalism, colonialism, and modernization went together from the colonial point of view. From our point of view, from Indian point of view, you could see that this science or this technology was in many ways, in many critical ways, was more for, you know, colonial exploitation, colonial subjugation, and also education, colonial education and administration. So for them, what they called in terms of their rhetorics as modernization and development, we can see it's just colonial exploitation. The science which we see, which we often think, which we often tend to think that it liberates, science as a proper form of knowledge leads to liberation, leads to progress, leads to development, leads to growth. But if we see in the colonial context, in its colonial setting, not in the post-colonial setting, when India became independent and adopted its own regime of scientific development and growth, or research and development, which was based on a different agenda. But as long as it was within a colonial setting, what we could see that the idea or the objective of promoting science and technology was not only linked to establishment of a colonial order, and along with this, it was also more of, you know, colonial exploitation. That is what we need to also take note of. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you, sir.
Can all of you hear? Can you all of you hear?
Yes, sir.
Can I get some response from the students? Please, ma'am, you know, get away from your background noise. Amit, could you please ask the students to come up with few questions,
yes,
so that so that we can also, you know, go ahead with a few other dimensions of discussion. That would be more interesting, because I've been talking all the while and without any interruptions. That doesn't make the discussion more exciting. Unless until some people, That would be great. Just give me 1 or 2 minutes break, huh? I'm coming back.
Okay, okay.
Okay. Okay,
Yes.
start preparing your question. 2-3 minutes and I'll come back.
Yes, sir. Planners, kisi questions achi pochaya chaunchan ko sir asile kindly pochari paribe.
Sakir, Sakir,
sir, sir.
आज जाओ पिला ऑप्शन 15 डाक उन्हें।
हाँ हाँ। जहाँ रखी क्वेश्चन पचारी बार रची सबने सार आसील अपने पचारी बारी बेला frequently क्वेश्चन पचारी बारी भी नो प्रॉब्लम। और सर कौन?
आप कहाँ एक पिला बेसी असले बोला था आसपार नहीं 22-23 लेकिन दिया आसपार के जानी आप दूसरा क्लास होची। बाबूजी ये 23 पर हिस्ट्री क्लास बंद कर दला है वो पिलावन को तो इंटरेस्ट नहीं तो कहाँ करूँ मैं तो 22-23 लेटी के पिला आसी जाऊँ तो कहाँ करा जी बाबू
एक्सक्यूज मी सर how many students are there in the history subject, sir? History PG in master degree of history.
122.
Okay, 122. Okay, sir. And among 122, there is only 15 to 20 students are regularly coming to this. So,
not regularly. On Saturday, there were hardly 8 or 7 students. I think students are not interested in taking, I mean, attending classes. Kar icha nahi ni kon bai tamane resource person ko dakwa. Shiva babu apan 22-23 re dekhun ke pila asbe tapore history class au mane korbar mu justification kichhi nahi paibar. Ki ko? Kaan? Tomar opinion kana kaho Shiva?
নাই স্যার মানে আমার কানে কি ডিস্টেন্স কোর্স রে বহুত গুডে মানে করজন মানে কি কিছু এনগেজ অন কিছু ফিল্ড রে তো সে মানে বোধ নেই পারবা নেই আসি পারবা জয়েন করিনি পারবা বাট ফির বাকি মানে যে মানে 15-20 জন আসছেন যে মানে ইন্টারেস্ট হচ্ছে সে মানে তো হেম পড়ে যাবে না
হ্যাঁ নাই নাই ক্লাস করবা এমনি কিছু ক্লাস করার জন্য টিকে রিকোয়েস্ট সে টিকে পিলা আসলে
আইয়া আইয়া
পারসন টিকে
ठीक
है भल रिसोर्स
Yes. Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Can you ask Professor Mishra to be there with the microphone?
Yes, yes. I am there. Chandu, I am there with you from the beginning. Just 2 minutes.
Yeah,
I went to washroom. Kondu.
But.
Kondu.
Okay, but my point is, I mean, I was just wondering whether you were there or not. That's why I called up.
How can I be absent when professors?
No, 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 my point, no, 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 it's not like that. I just wanted to get few comments and observations from students. That's what I wanted.
Yeah, yeah, that's what we're telling the students.
If you can. Yeah, please come.
We've already
so that that will be better because I have been talking. I don't know whether I've been talking sense or nonsense, but let me get some quick comments. Maybe they can defer and they can also come up with few questions. So that be good.
Okay, learners, yes. Please, I mean, clear your doubts with Professor Nanda or any questions.
Hello, sir.
Yes, please. You introduce yourself. Huh? I'll be happy to that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Myself, Shivaprasad sir. And good noon to all of you, sir. Good noon to all of you, sir. And especially thanks to the professor, sir, for giving us his valuable time to enlighten us. My question is that, sir, as you are telling, in many fields, the British had contributed so much. But I think there may be some field in which we lag behind due to the British rules or colonial rules. So can we explain about in which fields we are lag behind due to the colonial rule or British rules, sir?
Listen, Siva, you are a master's student, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I thought that you are from this Open University system. Okay. Now, please, Siva, try to understand. I have never said the contributions. I never, my lecture was not intended to highlight the contributions of the British. In many ways, this was not the intent of this lecture. What I basically tried to project before you, tried to delineate before you, the processes through which the idea of science and technology was transmitted to now. Basically, it started with this fundamental assumption that if you look at 18th century, 17th century, or the post-enlightenment Europe, it's the site of what you call modern knowledge. And this modern knowledge is basically constitutive of what you call this modern science and technology. And when that was, I mean, that and the fundamental elements of it is based on rationalism, positivism, sense perceptions, and direct observation, positivism, whatever we learn from, I mean, we usually use in our discursive aspects. So when we think through ideas, think through philosophies, think through our imagination, modern imagination, which we think as rational, which we think as more scientific, more progressive, more acceptable, more logical, all these ideas, which are basically traced to a particular point of time, some or other, the way knowledge, modern knowledge has been framed, the disciplines around which this modern knowledge, all these disciplines, whether it is, biology, geology, zoology, geography, physics, chemistry, botany, anthropology, history, all these disciplinary knowledge, which is part of modern knowledge, suddenly came to be constituted at a particular point of time. This is called Enlightenment, post-Enlightenment traditions. Of course, there is no dearth of example to suggest that India didn't have huge knowledge traditions. Max Weber said that maybe India lagged in technology, but in the technology of contemplation, in the technology of introspection, India was really going brilliant. India was absolutely marvelous. You cannot simply, in terms of this technology of thinking, technology of intellectual reflection or philosophical introspection, Indians. None, something like that. So that was a kind of epistemology. That was a kind of epistemology is basically theory of knowledge. If Europe basically valorized or tried to substantialize or tried to emphasize on a tradition of epistemology which was based on positivism, which was based on sense perception, and which suddenly emerged in the Enlightenment context and then was transmitted to other parts of the globe, whether it is Latin America, Africa, India, because of colonialism. And that came to be, you know, imposed because they had political rule, and they, because of this political power, also control of our nation, and the education is chemistry, geography, one subject to see. And as part of that, they also transmitted all these ideas of, you know, rationality, positivism to your mind. And in the process, your epistemology of your theory of knowledge, which was based on philosophical reflection, introspection, suddenly appeared to have vanished, and you have been a part of a victim, and you are started accepting this knowledge. Could be one way of then our tradition, knowledge suddenly vanished, and we started, you know, receiving the European. It's not like that. And we don't want to also suggest that India didn't have any tradition of scientific thinking or technological. It's not like that, because both in the ancient context and also in the medieval times, we have a lot of very reference to the fact that, which mentions very clearly that India was one of those first countries which you know, cultivated science. But this colonialism, which we hold is responsible, colonialism or imperialism, the way it shaped our imaginary through these disciplines, through a kind of political control like colonialism, they tried to hegemonize, or they tried to establish their hold, intellectual hold on all of us. Of course, science, these ideas are not bad, not at all bad. These are very important to like some of the ideas which came like India, the other one is the metropolis like Britain. See, many of these ideas of metropolis, the science, what you call the science today, that nature of science, or that contour of science, the size of science, the texture of science, continue to develop for a long time. You know, it's not simply in the 18th century that whatever botany you read in 18th century, whatever, you know, geology you read in 19th century, or whatever environment science you did in 19th century remained the same till today. It has really developed. And particularly in the 19th century, the way, you know, botany, the way, you know, geology, or the way geography was imagined initially when in the Europe, when these people came to India and they looked at a different geography, different geology, different botanical structure, these ideas were now sought to be integrated, to the theoretical understanding of the botany, geology, geography, which is already there in Europe. And these new data or these new ideas sought to challenge, transform the structure of these ideas. ତାଙ୍କ ଜୋଗ୍ରାଫର ମାନେ ଆସିଲେ, ତାଙ୍କର ବଟନିଷ୍ଟ ମାନେ ଆସିଲେ, ତାଙ୍କ ଫ୍ଲୋରା ଫୌନା ଗଛ ପଛ ଦେଖୁଛନ୍ତି, ସେସବୁ ଆଇଡିଆକୁ ନେଇକି ସେମାନେ ତାଙ୍କ ଥିଓରି ଯେଉଁ ପ୍ରକାର ଅଣ୍ଡରଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡିଂ ଥିଲା ସେଗୁଡ଼ା ସବୁ ଚେଞ୍ଜ ହେଉଛି। ଏନ୍ଭାୟରମେଣ୍ଟର ଆଇଡିଆ ବହୁତ ଚେଞ୍ଜ ହେଇଯାଉଛି, କାରଣ ସବୁ କଲୋନିଆଲ ବଟନିଷ୍ଟ, କଲୋନିଆଲ ଫ୍ୟାକ୍ଟର୍ସ, କଲୋନିଆଲ ମେଡିକାଲ ମ୍ୟାନ୍, ଏମାନେ ବହୁତ କଥା ଚେଞ୍ଜ। ଡିଜିଜ୍ର କନସେପ୍ସନ୍ ଚେଞ୍ଜ ହେଇଯାଉଛି, ଗୋଟେ ଏସିଆଟିକ୍ କଲେରା ବୋଲି ଗୋଟେ କଥା କହୁଛନ୍ତି, କଲେରା ଗୋଟେ ନୂଆ ଆଇଡିଆ ଆସୁଛି, ୟୁରୋପରେ ନଥିଲା ଯୋଉଟା, କେମିତି କଲେରା ହୁଏ, ତାର ଇନଫେକ୍ସନଟା କଣ ହୁଏ, ଏଇଟା ୟୁରୋପରୁ ବାହାରି ପାରିନି, କାରଣ ଡିଫରେଣ୍ଟ ଜାଗାରେ ଡିଫରେଣ୍ଟ ଆଇଡିଆ ଅଛି। ତ ଇଟ୍ସ ନଟ୍ ଲାଇକ୍ ଦାଟ, ସାଇନ୍ସର କ୍ୟାରେକ୍ଟରଟା ଗୋଟେ ୟୁନିଭର୍ସାଲ କ୍ୟାରେକ୍ଟର, ଏବଂ ସେ ୟୁନିଭର୍ସାଲ କ୍ୟାରେକ୍ଟରଟାର ଡିଟର୍ମିନେସନ କେବଳ ୟୁରୋପରୁ ହେଇଛି। ଯେଉଁ ୟୁନିଭର୍ସାଲିଟି ଅଫ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଡିପେଣ୍ଡସ୍ ଅନ୍ ଏକ୍ସପ୍ଲୋରିଂ ମୋର୍ ଅଫ୍ ରିଜିଅନ୍ସ ଅଫ୍ ଦି ୱାର୍ଲ୍ଡ, ୱାର୍ଲ୍ଡର ବହୁତ ଜାଗାକୁ ଦେଖିଲେ, ତା ଭିତରୁ ଯେଉଁ ପ୍ରକାର ଡେଟା ଆସିବ ସେସବୁ ଜିନିଷକୁ ନେଇକି ତମେ ତିଆରି କରିବ। କିନ୍ତୁ କଥା କ'ଣ ହେଲା, ଇଣ୍ଡିଆକୁ ଆମେ ୟୁଜ୍ କରାଗଲା, କଲୋନିଆଲିଷ୍ଟ ମାନେ ୟୁଜ୍ କଲେ ଫିଲ୍ଡ ଭଳିଆ, ଡେଟା ବ୍ୟାଙ୍କ ଭଳିଆ, ପ୍ରାକ୍ଟିସ୍ ଭଳିଆ, କିନ୍ତୁ ଥିଓରି ତିଆରି କଲାବେଳକୁ ସେଠୁ ତିଆରି ହେବ। କାହିଁକି ନା ସେମାନଙ୍କ ପାଖରେ ପଲିଟିକାଲ ପାୱାରର ଯେଉଁ ଇମ୍ବାଲାନ୍ସ ରହୁଛି, ଆମେ ହେଉଛୁ ସବଜୁଗେଟେଡ୍ ନେସନ, ଆମେ କଲୋନାଇଜ୍ ନେସନ, କଲୋନାଇଜ୍ର ଭଏସ୍ ନାହିଁ। ଏମାନେ ଆସିକି ଆମକୁ ଯେଉଁ ଜିନିଷ ଦେଖୁଛନ୍ତି ତାକୁ ନେଇ ଥାଉଛନ୍ତି, ଯେଉଁଟା ଯେତେବେଳେ ଆମେ ଯେତେବେଳେ ଡିକଲୋନାଇଜେସନ୍ ହେଉଛି, ଯେତେବେଳେ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ଇଣ୍ଡିପେଣ୍ଡେଣ୍ଟ ହେଉଛି, ଯେତେବେଳେ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ପଲିଟିକାଲ ଇଣ୍ଡିପେଣ୍ଡେନ୍ସ ପାଉଛି, ଆମେ ନିଜର ରିସର୍ଚ୍ଚ ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟ। ଆଜି ଯଦି ଗୋଟେ ଲ୍ୟାବ୍ ତିଆରି ହେଉଛି କରୋନା ଭ୍ୟାକ୍ସିନ୍କୁ ନେଇକିନା, ଆମେ କ'ଣ ଭ୍ୟାକ୍ସିନ୍ ତିଆରି ହେବ, ଗୋଟେ ଲ୍ୟାବ୍ ରହୁଛି, ଆମେ ହଠାତ୍ ଏବେ ରିଅଲାଇଜ୍ କରୁ ଯେ ଆମ ପାଖରେ ପର୍ସନାଲ ପ୍ରୋଟେକ୍ଟିଭ ଇକ୍ୱିପମେଣ୍ଟ ନାହିଁ। ଏବେ ଆମେ ଯେଉଁଟା ବର୍ତ୍ତମାନ କହୁଛେ 3 ମାସ ପରେ ଯେ ଆମର ବର୍ତ୍ତମାନ ଆତ୍ମନିର୍ଭରଶୀଳ ହେଇଗଲୁଣି, ଆମେ ଦିନକୁ 2 ଲକ୍ଷ ପିପି ତିଆରି କରୁଛୁ, ଆମେ ଏ ଜିନିଷ କରୁଛୁ, ଆମେ ବର୍ତ୍ତମାନ ଆୟୁଷ ମନ୍ତ୍ରାଳୟକୁ କହିଲୁଣି ଆମେ ଔଷଧ କରୁଛୁ, ଆମେ ଏଇଟାକୁ ଭ୍ୟାକ୍ସିନ୍ ପାଇଁ ବି ଆମେ ଟେଷ୍ଟ କରୁଛୁ। ହଠାତ୍ ଆମେ କାହିଁ ଏ ଜିନିଷରେ ପବ୍ଲିକ ହେଲ୍ଥ ପ୍ରତି କନସିୟସ ହେଇନୁ? ଆମର ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ଲ୍ୟାଗ୍ ଯେଉଁ ରହିଛି 70 ଇୟର୍ସ ତାରିଖି, ଯେଉଁଟା ୟୁରୋପରେ ସବୁ କଣ୍ଟ୍ରି ଦି ମୋମେଣ୍ଟ ଏଟା ଆରମ୍ଭ ହେଲା, ସେମାନଙ୍କ ସେ ଯେଉଁ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜିର ଯେଉଁ ଗୋଟେ ଅଟୋମେଟିକ ଯେଉଁ ମୋମେଣ୍ଟମ୍ ରହିଛି, ଯେ ଯଦି ଗୋଟେ ଭଳିଆ କ୍ରାଇସିସ୍ ଆସିଲା, ଦେନ୍ ୱି ହାଭ୍ ଟୁ କ୍ୟାଚ୍ ଅପ୍ ୱିଥ୍ ନ୍ୟୁ ଏରିଆଜ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଅଣ୍ଡରଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡିଂ, ନ୍ୟୁ ଏରିଆଜ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଇନୋଭେଟିଭ୍ ମେଡିସିନ୍, କିଛି କରିବାକୁ ଆମେ କରିପାରିବୁ। ଯେଉଁ ଲ୍ୟାଗ୍ଟା ଇଟ୍ କ୍ୟାନ୍ ବି ଟ୍ରେସ୍ ଟୁ କଲୋନିଆଲ୍ ପିରିୟଡ୍, ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ପ୍ରକାର ଆମର ଯେଉଁ ଇମ୍ବାଲାନ୍ସ ତିଆରି ହେଇଛି ସେତେବେଳେ ସବୁଠି ଲ୍ୟାଗ୍ ତିଆରି ହେଇଛି, ଯେଉଁ ଜିନିଷଟା ଆମର ଥାଇକି ବି ଆଗରୁ ଯେଉଁ ଜିନିଷଟା ଯେଉଁ 18th century ବା ସେ ଯେଉଁ ଆସ୍ତେ ଆସ୍ତେ ଆମର ଗୋଟେ ପ୍ରକାର, ଏଇ ଗୋଟେ କଥାକୁ ତମେ ଯେଉଁ କଥାଟା ପଚାରିଲ, କାହିଁକି ଆମ ଷ୍ଟ୍ରେଙ୍ଥ କେଉଁଠି ଥିଲା, ଆମର ୱିକନେସ୍ କେଉଁଠି ଥିଲା, ତାର ତମେ ଯାହା ପଚାରିଲ ସେଇ କାରଣରୁ ତମେ କହିଲ ଯେ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆର ଷ୍ଟ୍ରେଙ୍ଥଟା କ'ଣ, ମୁଁ କହିବି ବହୁତ ତମକୁ ଷ୍ଟ୍ରେଙ୍ଥଟା କ'ଣ ଦେଖିବାକୁ ପଡ଼ିବ, ୱିକନେସ୍ଟାକୁ ଦେଖିବାକୁ ପଡ଼ିବ। ସେ ୱିକନେସ୍ ହେଉଛି ଯେଉଁ ଲିମିଟେସନ୍ ହେଉଛି ଇଣ୍ଡିଆର, ଆମେ ଯେଉଁ ଗୋଟେ ପିରିୟଡ୍ ଭିତରେ ଯେତିକି ଆମର ଯେଉଁ ପ୍ରି କଲୋନିଆଲ ପିରିୟଡ୍ ଭିତରେ ବ୍ରିଟିଶ ଆସିବା ଆଗରୁ ଯେଉଁ ସମୟ, ତା ଭିତରେ ହୁଏତ ଆମର ଯେଉଁ କଲଚରାଲ ଆଉ ଇଣ୍ଟେଲେକ୍ଚୁଆଲ ଏଲିଟ୍ସ ମାନେ କଲଚରାଲ ଆଉ ସୋସିଆଲ ଅର୍ଡର ଯେଉଁଟା ଥିଲା, ଯେଉଁ ଅର୍ଡର ଥିଲେ, ସେମାନଙ୍କର ଫେଲିଅର ହେଇଛି ଟୁ ଆପ୍ରିସିଏଟ ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ଯେଉଁ ପ୍ରକାର ଗ୍ଲୋବାଲ ଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡାର୍ଡ। ଯେତେବେଳେ ୟୁରୋପରେ 17th 18th century ଯେଉଁଭଳିଆ ରିସର୍ଚ୍ଚ ହେଉଛି ସାଇନ୍ସ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜିକୁ ନେଇକି, ଆମେ ତାକୁ କ୍ୟାଚ୍ ଅପ୍ କରିପାରୁନି, ଏବଂ ଏ ଜିନିଷ ସବୁଆଡ଼େ ଆରମ୍ଭ ହେଇଛି ସେହି ସମୟରେ 18th century ଇରାନରେ ହେଉଛି, ସବୁ କଲଚରରେ ହେଉଛି, ଯେ ଆମେ ଇନୱାର୍ଡ ଲୁକିଂ ଟ୍ରାଡିସନ୍ ବାଉଣ୍ଡ ହେଇକି ରହୁଛୁ, ଆମେ ଦେଖିପାରୁନି। ଇନସୁଲାର ଯେଉଁ ଟୋପିକାର ଶ୍ରମ କଥା କହୁଥିଲେ, ଆମେ ଡରିକି ପଳାଉଛେ ଯେ କାହିଁକି ସେ ଯିଏ ଯିଏ କ୍ୟାପ୍ ପିନ୍ଧିଛି, ଯିଏ ୟୁରୋପିଆନ ଯାହାଫଳରେ ଗନ୍ର ନଲେଜ୍ ଅଛି, ଯାହାର ସିପ୍ର ନଲେଜ୍, ତାକୁ ଦେଖିକି ତା ସାଙ୍ଗରେ ଏନଗେଜ୍ ହେବା ପରିବର୍ତ୍ତେ ଆମେ ପଳାଉଛୁ, ଯାହା କିଛି ଦରକାର ନାହିଁ, ସେମାନେ ଆସିଲେ ଆମକୁ ଅସୁବିଧାରେ ପକେଇବେ। ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ଇନସୁଲାରିଟିଟା ରହୁଛି, ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ମେ ନଟ୍ ବି ଏ ପାନ୍ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆନ୍ ଫେନୋମେନନ୍, ବଟ୍ ଆଟ୍ ଦି ସେମ୍ ଟାଇମ୍ ଇଟ୍ ଅଲସୋ ଏକ୍ସପ୍ଲେନ୍ସ ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ସମ୍ ଅର୍ ଅଦର ଗୋଟେ ଇନସୁଲାରିଟି ନିଜ ଭିତରେ ରହିଯିବାର ଯେଉଁ ଟେଣ୍ଡେନ୍ସିଟା ଡେଭଲପ୍ କରୁଛି 18th century 17th century, ଯେଉଁଥିପାଇଁ ଆମେ ପଛେଇ ମାନେ ଯେଉଁ ଲ୍ୟାଗ୍ଟା ତିଆରି ହେଉଛି ଡେଫିନେଟଲି, କିନ୍ତୁ ତା ମାନେ ନୁହେଁ ଯେ ସେ ପିରିୟଡ଼ରେ ରାମକୃଷ୍ଣ ରାମମୋହନ ରୟକୁ ଦେଖ, ଜାମ୍ବେକର ବମ୍ବେରେ ଜଣେ ମ୍ୟାଥମେଟିସିଆନ ଅଛନ୍ତି, ଯେଉଁ ଇଣ୍ଟେଲେକ୍ଚୁଆଲ ଅଛନ୍ତି, ସମସ୍ତେ ମଡର୍ଣ୍ଣ ସାଇନ୍ସକୁ ପ୍ରୋତ୍ସାହନ ଦେଉଛନ୍ତି। ମୁଁ ଯେଉଁ କଥା କହୁଥିଲି, ବହୁତ ଇଣ୍ଟେଲେକ୍ଚୁଆଲ ଅଛନ୍ତି, ବହୁତ ଅର୍ଗାନାଇଜେସନ ଆସିଛି ଯେଉଁମାନେ କହୁଛନ୍ତି ନାଇଁ ଆମେ ମଡର୍ଣ୍ଣ ସାଇନ୍ସ ସାଇନ୍ସକୁ ଇଏ କରିବା, ଆଟ୍ ଦି ସେମ୍ ଟାଇମ୍ ଆଉ ଗୋଟେ ସେକ୍ସନ୍ ବି ଅଛନ୍ତି ଯେଉଁମାନେ କହୁଛନ୍ତି ଆମ ଟ୍ରାଡିସନ୍କୁ ଦେଖିବା, ବହୁତ ମଡର୍ଣ୍ଣିଟିକୁ ଦେଖିବା, ଟ୍ରାଡିସନ୍କୁ ଦେଖିବା, ତେଣୁ ଗୋଟେ କିଏ କହୁଛନ୍ତି ରିଭାଇଭାଲିଷ୍ଟ ଟେଣ୍ଡେନ୍ସି ରହୁଛି, କିଏ ମଡର୍ଣ୍ଣିଷ୍ଟ ଟେଣ୍ଡେନ୍ସି ରହୁଛି, କିଏ ସିନ୍ଥେଟିକ୍ ଟ୍ରାଡିସନ୍ସ ରହୁଛି, ଇଏ ସବୁ ଭିତରେ କଲୋନିଆଲିଜିମ୍ ଆମକୁ ଶାସନ କରୁଛି 200 ବର୍ଷ। ଏହି ସବୁ ଭିତରେ ଆମର ଟେଷ୍ଟ, ଟେମ୍ପରାମେଣ୍ଟ, ଆଇଡ଼ିଆଜ, ଇମାଜିନାରିଜ୍ ଏ ସବୁକୁ ପରସିଭ୍ କରୁଛି। ତେଣୁ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜି ଗୋଟେ ପିଓର ଜିନିଷ ଯେମିତି ପଳେଇ ଆସିଲା ଏବଂ ଟ୍ରାନ୍ସପ୍ଲାଣ୍ଟ ହେଇଗଲା, ସେମିତି ନୁହେଁ। କାରଣ ଗୋଟାଏ ସମୟରେ ଯେତେବେଳେ ପଲିଟିକାଲ କଣ୍ଟ୍ରୋଲ ଆଉ ଗୋଟେ ପାୱାର ପାଖରେ ରହୁଛି, ତା ପାଖରେ ଏଜେଣ୍ଡା ରହୁଛି କି ଭଳିଆ ସାଇନ୍ସ ହେବ, କି ଭଳିଆ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜି ହେବ, ଏବଂ ତାକୁ ଇମ୍ପାକ୍ଟ ପକାଉଛି ଗୋଟେ ବଡ କଣ୍ଟ୍ରି, ଏତେ ବଡ କଣ୍ଟ୍ରି ଲାଇକ୍ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ତାର ସେପ୍ ତିଆରି କରୁଛି, ତାର ଫାର୍ ରିଚିଂ ଇମ୍ପ୍ଲିକେସନ୍ସ ରହୁଛି, ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ୱି ନିଡ୍ ଟୁ, ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ପ୍ରୋସେସ୍ଟାକୁ ଆମକୁ ଦେଖିବାକୁ ପଡ଼ିବ। ଆମେ ଯେଉଁ କହୁଛେ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜି ଆଣ୍ଡ ରାଜ, ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ କଲୋନିଆଲିଜିମ୍ ଗୋଟା ହେଉଛି ବଡ଼ ଫ୍ରେମୱାର୍କ ଯେଉଁ ଭିତରେ ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ଗୋଟେ ନୂଆ ନ୍ୟୁ ନଲେଜ୍ ଟ୍ରାଡିସନ୍ ଯେତେବେଳେ ଆସୁଛି ତାକୁ କଲୋନିଆଲିଜିମ୍ କେମିତି ମେଡିଏଟ୍ କରୁଛି, କି ଭଳିଆ ମଧ୍ୟସ୍ଥତା କରିକି ଆମ ମାନସିକ ସ୍ତରରେ ଆମର ଯେଉଁଟା କୁହନ୍ତି ଇଣ୍ଟେଲେକ୍ଚୁଆଲ ଯେଉଁଟା ଅଛି କ'ଣ ଅଛି ବୌଦ୍ଧିକ ସ୍ତରରେ ଆମକୁ କେମିତି ପ୍ରଭାବ ପକାଉଛି, ପ୍ରଭାବ ବିସ୍ତାର କରୁଛି, ସେଇଟା ଜାଣିବା, ସେଇଟାକୁ ମ୍ୟାପ୍ କରିବା ହେଉଛି ଗୋଟେ ହିଷ୍ଟୋରିଆନ୍, କ୍ରିଟିକାଲ ସୋସିଆଲ ହିଷ୍ଟୋରିଆନ୍ ଅଫ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ, ଯେଉଁମାନେ ସାଇନ୍ସ ସୋସିଆଲ ହିଷ୍ଟୋରିଆନ୍ ତୋ ଯୁ ଆର୍ ଡୁଇଂ ହିଷ୍ଟ୍ରି ଅଫ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଟେକ୍ନୋଲୋଜି ମେଡିସିନ୍ ଆଜ୍ ଆଇ ସେଡ୍ ଅଲସୋ ଅଫ୍ କୋର୍ସ ଦି ଅନଲାଇନ୍ ମୋଡ୍ ଅଫ୍ କମ୍ୟୁନିକେସନ୍ ଅର୍ କମ୍ପ୍ୟୁଟର ଫର୍ ଦାଟ୍ ମ୍ୟାଟର, ସେମାନଙ୍କୁ ଏଇ ପ୍ରୋସେସ୍କୁ ଜାଣିବାକୁ ପଡ଼ିବ, କେବଳ କଲୋନିଆଲ ପିରିୟଡ଼ ନୁହେଁ, ଆଜିକାଲି ହୁଏ, ଆଜି ତ ହୁଏ ତ ପୁଣି ତ ପୋଷ୍ଟ କଲୋନିଆଲ ପିରିୟଡ଼ରେ ହୁଏ, ତେଣୁ ଡିଡ୍ ଇଟ୍ ମେକ୍ ସେନ୍ସ ଶିବ? ହ୍ୟାଲୋ 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 ହ୍ୟାଲୋ
Yes, sir.
କ୍ୟାନ୍ ୟୁ ହିୟର୍ ମି?
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
ଶିବ କାନ୍ତି, ଶିବ ଶିବ ବାବୁ ଯିଏ ପଚାରୁଥିଲେ ସେ କୁଆଡ଼େ ଗଲେ? ଓରେ ଜି ଆଜି ଲେଫ୍ଟ
ହି ହାଜ୍ ଲେଫ୍ଟ ଆଇ ଥିଙ୍କ ଶିବ ଇଜ୍ ନଟ୍ ଦେୟାର
ବଟ୍ ହି ଆସ୍କ୍ ଦି କ୍ୱେଶ୍ଚନ୍ ବଟ୍ ହି ହାଜ୍ ଲେଫ୍ଟ
ପ୍ରଫେସର ନନ୍ଦ ମୋର ଗୋଟେ ଅବଜରଭେସନ୍ ଥିଲା ମେ ଆଇ ସେୟାର ୱିଥ୍ ୟୁ
ୟେସ୍ ୟେସ୍ ପ୍ଲିଜ୍ ୟା ପ୍ଲିଜ୍
ଆଇ ମିନ୍ ଆଜ୍ ଫାର୍ ଆଜ୍ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆନ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ ଇଜ୍ କନ୍ସର୍ନ It's like a flow in the river, starting from early historic times, medieval times, modern times. We are basically concerned here with the colonial period. And how right, far sir. Our nationalist movement looked towards this problem? On the 18th, you talked about the legacy of the nationalist movement compared to fundamental rights or civic liberties or secularism. I think Indian National Congress didn't pay much attention to this science and technology problem. Am I right or?
Yeah. No, you are perfectly right. No, you are perfectly right. I mean, in terms of amount of gaze, amount of attention which would have been paid to, promotion of this, promotion of this idea in terms of a policy framework, even though it came to be articulated from 1930s with proactive proactive engagement of Nehru with this question.
Yes.
Of course, at everyday politics level, it was not very much there. Of course, broadly, since Indian National Congress believed in ideas of progress, region, and also when it came to question of economic development, it very seriously endorsed this principle of science and technology.
Yes.
Modern science and technology, not science and technology, modern science and technology, the way science and technology has developed in Europe. That was a very clear agenda, which Karachi resolution also very seriously reiterated. That is one. But at the same time, I would say that this, because the Indian National Congress from the day one, since its inception, believed in all these values of democracy, the way it had come in England and Europe, because it uncritically endorsed to these principles, within this framework of references, the belief in science and technology was very much there. So I don't think that is why they often tended to believe that that they are promoting science and technology in certain ways, and they are in for it, that they are absolutely in favor of it. But it was a different, absolutely, it is a different reality, that only after India became independent, that a separate and distinct policy of science and technology could be, crafted and could be implemented only after we had independent government. So from, from colonial period to the post-colonial period, when we look at the way science transitioned, it also constitutes a different moment. in the post-colonial context, in the post-independent context, the way science was pursued was certainly linked to a very substantial foundation, substantial foundation in terms of a conceptual foundation which had gone into the establishment of it. Because Nehru, by late 1930s, had been in touch with all these scientists of this country, and think of Swaminathan, think of all Homi Bhabha, all these, the Pasarabhai Foundation, all these institutions which suddenly came up soon after the independence, because they had almost decided that these are the scientists who are going to, give a lead to this country. Because Nehru had this vision, and he thought that without a very strong, robust scientific base, this country cannot take up, cannot be on the road of modernity. So all these big scientists, which we see, whether it is industrial revolution, whether it is white revolution, everything, agricultural revolution, all these revolutions were sought to be crafted on the basis of a particular blueprint. And this blueprint had been very carefully prepared with the endorsement of all these sets of ideological persuasion, whether right, left, center, whatever, everybody had endorsed to this. And without this blueprint, this could not have been possible soon after independence. I think national movement had very clearly endorsed to the principle of scientific development, technological development, and because of this, that the idea of growth and development based on science and technology could be possible soon after independence. I think this could be partly a sort of explanation for what you asked. Can you hear me, sir? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. You are very much right, Professor Nanda, because in 1930 is the landmark year in Indian science, because C.V. Raman got Nobel Prize in diffusion of light on that day. And much of the credit goes to Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. People are criticizing Nehru these days very much, but it was he who laid a foundation of modern science in India. He told these are the all these institutions that you said, and all these things he did after independence, actually it led to the foundation of a modern science in India. But did it continue after, say, 1970s or 80s or 90s? Because we don't find an Indian scientist of much repute as it was there. All the Nobel laureates, they are American citizens. Now, how would you view this? Why this tradition was broken? Just some observation, Professor Nanda.
You mean to say that after 1970s?
70s or 80s, I mean, there is development of science, no doubt. But we hardly find any reputed scientists. We're taking pride in C.V. Raman or J.C. Bose or P.C. Rice, all those things in colonial period. But except in economic science, except in economic science, Amartya Sen or Abhijit Banerjee exceptions. Why? I mean, in physics, chemistry, all those things, we don't find a name of an Indian citizen. Actually, I mean, naturalized American citizens, I mean, Indian citizens are there in states. But what could be the reason? I mean, just I mean, this
reason
is an observation.
Is, observation could be. I mean, this is a very question which needs to be dealt with at a longer and a more.
Yes, I may be wrong, but just an observation.
No, it's not a wrong. It's not a wrong. It's a very serious question. But there are, it's a. It begs a deep, broader explanation. But to quickly put it into a kind of, explanatory framework, I could argue starting with the way we try to perceive this question in terms of why suddenly there is a decline of community of scientists who are committed in a different way all these the big names you talked about are all are product of a particular time, you know, and they had a different ideological orientation, mooring what you call the Nehruvian times and this nationalist ideological influence was very, you know, high on them, something like that. But suddenly in the post 70s and particularly post 80s and post 90s, what is happening? So this is again question which is linked to the question of globalization. I think that's more important, and the staying within the nationalist walls and going out of it in an interconnected globe where you know, larger demographies like India, democracies and demographies like India may lose its somewhat relevance. But at the same time, if you look at the pace of you know, science, growth of science and technology across the globe, it has been stupendous. It may not, I mean, even though it has started from few of the centers, but it has also it also implies that it's not no more the center like Europe, which is again dominant. China has become more important. Japan has become more important. The idea of 19th century Europe dominating or driving the agenda of development and science technology is gone. Maybe India, as it is being touted, as it's being, you know, often imagined that 21st century is the century of India. Of course, it's, you know, it has to be strived for. So the local, the platforms, the centers are shifting. It's no more Europe, it's no more only America, could be. But now, so it is in that broader perspective, I would try to, you know, advance this explanation, saying that, you know, the centers of power, centers of knowledge, centers of modernity, the way it has been looked in the earlier centuries, is now shifting to other, you know, theaters of the globe, other locales of the globe. Maybe India also participates in this. Why not? Because now we see this. So, I mean, we can see the rate of literacy, the way it has grown, and number of people who have gone to different, migrated, and look at the, what do you call this, overseas population, the intellectuals, the intelligentsia, the way they have migrated to other countries, and they have the diasporic community. So if we take into account the contributions made to the growth of humanity and the contribution to the field of, to the domain of science and technology by these people, and since we are living in a borderless space, and it is a global village, then we need to see this, reformulate this question from this angle than saying this, that we need to, why should we lament saying that after 70s nothing is happening in India? Maybe people from this part of this globe are more active in different other parts, trying to, you know, project themselves from that end, you know. It's like, you know, playing cricket and you know, bowling from double ends, from one end like India, from American end, but the player remains the same. I mean, the player remains to a particular team. So Indians can bowl from India, Indians can bowl from America, something like that. This is kind of, this could be a kind, that is what, you know, it comes to my mind abruptly to answer to your very important question. Okay, we can talk about that also.
No, Professor Nanda, I mean, very much thankful to you, and give a very, you gave a very good, I mean, comparison. Whether it's a bowler, it's an Indian from America or Indian from India. A lovely comparison, a lovely simile. Thank you very much, Dr. Nanda, for your lecture. And now, any students? Otherwise, Dr. Shakir Hussain will summarize and we'll end the session. If any more questions are there, you are free to ask. Otherwise, we'll end the session. Dr. Shakir.
Thank you, Nanda sir. And yes, of course, we have many more things like in history to be in future. We have to be incorporated in our syllabus, and the students should be multidisciplinary in and don't be confined themselves in the traditional pattern of history.